Let freedom reign. Let freedom reign. I'm going to be preaching from Galatians chapter 5. I'm going to touch on verse 1, and I want to touch on verse 13, 14, and 15. Okay? So it's called Let Freedom Reign. Last night I was trying to write this sermon, and one unique thing happened was that I couldn't write it because there was so much fireworks. And they went on to about 2 o'clock in this morning. They just bang and boom and everything you can name. And I don't have any problem with people enjoying the day. I believe you should grasp hold of life. You should enjoy life as best you can. But when it gets to the point where your freedom imposes on someone else, it becomes a problem. And so this is kind of the scope of the word today. In commemoration to Independence Day, which was yesterday, I wanted to give a 4th of July sort of word. And so I remember, I don't know if anyone's around my age, I'm like 30 plus. Y'all can decide what is plus. When I was a kid, one of the songs we used to sing in school, I don't know if y'all remember, along with reciting the Pledge of Allegiance, was a song called My Country, Tears of Thee, Tis of Thee. Now, for those that have never heard, don't worry, because here's the good news for you. I'm going to sing it for you. I know y'all love to hear me sing. And some of y'all said, no, that really hurts my feelings. My Country, Tis of Thee was a patriotic song that praises the United States for its liberty and justice. And I can only imagine when it was written. It was written by a gentleman named Samuel Francis Smith in 1831. And this song was first sang in public on July 4th. So it makes sense that we would bring this song up on July 4th. It was on July 4th of that same year of 1831 at a children's concert in Park Street, at Park Street Church in Boston. And since the song was sang to the tune of British God Save the King, I can only assume it was written as a slap in the face to the British Empire by a small upstart country that had by that time been 98 years free from under the thumb of the British rule. The song was simple and it was catchy, which made it easy for children to learn. It went, my country, tears of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims' pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. The expression Let Freedom Ring was coined by Samuel Francis Smith to signify a time when bells would ring to tell the people of the town that there was going to be an enemy coming or there was danger. Or it was sometimes used when the bells were sometimes rang to let people know that there had been a victory or a celebration. If a child was being born in a town, if it was some major person's birthday, they would sound the bells. It was called Let Freedom Ring. In the song and in a memorable I Had a Dream speech by Martin Luther King on August 28th, 1963, Let Freedom Ring was meant to signify an echoing of freedom and liberty and justice across the country. For Samuel Francis Smith, Let Freedom Ring boasted the reality of a country that had, by the will of God, wrenched itself from the grip of a monarchy, a great and powerful empire, some 98 years prior. For Dr. Martin Luther King, Let Freedom Ring was the hope of a coming reality in these United States where color of a person's skin would not be a determinant in its opportunity and punishment, in the application of justice, or the inalienable right of our Constitution, which so adamantly promises us to be treated as human beings. Today, Let Freedom Ring implies the possible reality where we as citizens of this great nation will be able to do as we wish, whenever we wish, any way we wish, and the authority and the powers and those whom, whatever it is that we do, directly or indirectly affects them, would just leave us alone. Today, Let Freedom Ring is the right to claim by so many groups, the right to treat other groups with no respect, to take advantage of the weak, to impose our will on them based on our political views or our financial status. Today, Let Freedom Ring gives us the right to be both prosecutor, judge, and jury on a group of people based on their race, based on their religion, based on their skin color, based on their sexual orientation, based on anything that we can possibly name that separates them people from us. Today, Let Freedom Ring gives up its reality of 1861, and it gives up the hope of 1963. And the only freedom we as this country seeks is the insufferable desire to impose our will on our fellow man. Today I want to speak about attaining and living a life of freedom, not from the physical attribute, but from the spiritual realm. And if we can attain a spiritual freedom, freedom from God's perspective, not from man's perspective, it will affect the physical realm. And if we can attain a spiritual equality from God's perspective, it will affect our country's social issues. In the physical realm, I believe as long as we adjust freedom from the subjective view, we'll get a subjective freedom. One man's opinion of what freedom is very dynamic. Freedom is always changing if I use only my opinion, or if I use only your opinion, and never actually representative of the needs of all people. But if we would seek an objective view of freedom, a view from someone higher than us, someone better than us, someone that knows more than us, then maybe we'll get the right view of freedom. But as long as we're trying to fix things using earthly means, we're going to get earthly results. The results we've gotten over the last 400 years in this country has not fixed the problem with our social issues, and freedom has not ran. Today I want to talk about the benefits of seeing freedom from the spiritual realm. In Matthew 6:6, Jesus teaches, "Seek first the kingdom of God." And what he's saying, if we can grab hold of God's perspective, if we can get a spiritual point of view of the important issues of life, if we can reach heaven, and grab hold of that first, then God will take care of the rest. What saddens me is so many people, when they hear that verse, "Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added on it." So many Christians think this is a statement about Jesus, that Jesus makes about what our physical needs first. We say, well, we don't have to worry about what we should eat. God's going to take care of it. We got to worry. But what we need to understand is God wants to be in every part of our lives. There's no part of our life where God's saying, "Seek first the kingdom of God," that it doesn't apply. It applies in our personal lives. It applies in our finance. It applies in our social lives. It applies in our political views. It applies in every part. He's saying, "Seek me first." God says, Jesus says, "I won't be second in your life. Seek me first." He says that if you do that, I'll take care of all the minor stuff.
Hallelujah.
But so many of us refuse to seek God first. what we think is we can take our personal views, and if we say "and God" and with that statement of bigotry, and we can take our personal views and we say "but God" in that statement of wickedness, and we can say, take our personal views and we can say, maybe God or maybe Jesus did this, then maybe somehow we can. What do kids do on Instagram? I was asking my son last night. They take your picture and they filter something on it. They take a picture of you with the camera and they put little ears, doggy ears on it. Those are called filters. We're trying to filter God's word to suit our personal opinion. But Matthew 16:19, Jesus says, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you loose on earth will be loosened in heaven. And what you want to know that's going on is God has given us a direct association between what happens in heaven and what we experience here on earth. And so if we want to get the minor things here on earth corrected, we need to see a higher realm. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Anybody hear what I'm saying? Yes. Now, I need you to hear this from a spiritual standpoint, but I also need you to hear it from the standpoint of us reaching for freedom. In Matthew 16:19, it says, to bind, it talks about binding and loosing. Now, I want you to understand that to bind and loose actually means to restrain and to set free. And what Jesus is saying to the church is that the church is supposed to have heaven's keys. The church is supposed to have heaven's viewpoint, God's perspective, God's resources on all matters of life. And when we're operating out of God's perspective, in spite of how the world wants us to operate, then we can call on heaven's authority to bind hatred and injustice and loosen freedom and equality. It may be that this country is still slaves to hatred and injustice, bigotry and pride, because we would rather knock down the doors of freedom and justice with a battering ram of laws than open the doors of freedom and justice with the keys God gave us for heaven. We're trying to find earthly solutions to a heavenly problem. And so why did Jesus say, I have come to set you free? In Galatians 5:1, I'm going to give y'all a second because I'm going to talk, my word is actually out of Galatians 5. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, it says, Jesus says, for freedom, Christ set us free. Stand firm and don't submit again to the yoke of slavery. Now, sometimes we read that simple verse and we miss the obvious here. And there's nothing more obvious than the question that this one little verse answers. Why did Christ set us free? For freedom. Why did Christ bear our burdens? For freedom. Why was Jesus bruised for our iniquities? For freedom. Why did he die on the cross for punishment that was rightfully ours? For freedom. The pastor says, for freedom's sake. You see, before Christ and his work on the cross, every one of us was slaves. We were slaves to sin. We were servants of the Satan. In fact, the scripture teaches that even though we were created in the image of God, because of sin, we were not part of God's family. This is kind of confusing because a lot of people think just because I'm created in God's image that I'm one of God's children, but that's not so. The scripture tells us we have to be adopted into the family. And many people don't understand this truth. They go around calling God their father, but God has never called them son. However, because of the substitutionary work of Jesus Christ on the cross, because of the real work of the real Son of God, Not only are we reconciled to the Father, put in a right relationship with God. In fact, that's kind of hard, especially when you come to the realization. The scriptures tell us that we were enemies of God. It says, while we were still enemies of God, Jesus died for us. He put us in a right relationship with his Father. Jesus Christ did that for us. And when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we enter in not just into a good relationship with God. The scripture says we get adopted into his family.
Hallelujah.
I don't know if y'all know about that. I often talk about adoption up here. Adoption is a powerful thing. As a matter of fact, if you read the Old Testament, you'll find that adoption is more important than being born in a family.
Amen.
You can be born in a family. And how many people know there's somebody, your brothers, sisters, uncle, cousin, somebody in your family, you think, if he was in somebody else's family, I wouldn't be all that upset. If you don't think there's anybody, it's probably you. But the scripture says that adoption is a powerful thing. You know what adoption says? Adoption says, whereas we stuck with our brothers and sisters, adoption says, I select who I want in my family.
Hallelujah.
God says, there's some people who want to be a part of God's family, but God hasn't selected them. But when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you not only get reconciled, put in a right relationship with an almighty God, but God has selected you and he's adopted you into his family.
Hallelujah. Amen.
And even though we don't deserve it, there's nothing we did that made us worthy of that adoption. But God in his amazing love, his outstanding grace, his supernatural mercy takes us up. Those of us who are helpless, morally impoverished, will do anything before we came to know the Christ. We're debt laden, we're sinners, we've probably done some stuff we want to keep in the closet we don't want nobody to know about. He says, God says, I know all about those things, you haven't hid them from me, but I still love you so much, I'm going to adopt you into my family. So that our sin debts are canceled, and the glory that comes with being part of the family of the King of the universe is inherited to us. Jesus told Nicodemus, who was a religious leader of the Jews, truly I say unto you, unless you are born again, you can't see the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, there are no exceptions. There's no exceptions. You must be born again. It was for freedom's sake that Christ set us free. And what that means is no longer are we slaves to legalism, whereby we try to justify ourselves doing good works. No longer are we slaves to a pharisaical world of modern-day Judaizers who set a standard of God, that set a standard for God as to what we must do to be counted into God's kingdom. Let me put this another way. No longer are we slaves to people that tell us we have to do this in our lives or live that in our lives in order to be accepted by God. Instead, because we've been set free by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, we who believe do good, not to gain acceptance of some pious people who sit around pointing their fingers at us, and not to work our way in the heavens on our own merit. We know we can't do that. We who have put our faith in Jesus Christ do what is right because we're already accepted and we've already been adopted into the family of God. And I want to tell you something you might not have recognized up to this point. But when you come into the realization that your daddy is God, then you ain't nobody's slave. It was for freedom's sake that Christ set us free. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 and 15, it reads, for you were called to be free, brothers and sisters. Only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. But serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in this one statement. Love your neighbors as you love yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out, because you just might consume one another. One of the biggest problems with freedom is that false reality that it comes without a cost. That somehow freedom exists without boundaries. But whenever someone is willing, whether willingly or unwillingly, to practice that kind of freedom, he or she is willingly or unwillingly ready to steal the freedom of someone else. I'm not free to treat you in a way that makes you feel less than human. I'm not free to cause you to lose hope. I'm not free to treat you in a way that makes you leave feeling angry, make you leave feeling less than someone, makes you leave lusting after revenge. I don't have that kind of freedom. As a matter of fact, I can say with almost 100% surety that that's not freedom, that's oppression. Sadly, many people today think freedom is the ability to do whatever they want. But biblically, freedom is liberty from illegitimate bondage, so that you can enjoy the responsibility of a new relationship with God and fulfill your divine ordained purpose. Let me repeat that again. Freedom is the liberty from illegitimate bondage, so that you can enjoy the responsibility of a new relationship with God and fulfill your divinely ordained purpose. I've said this before, and any of you have been here about to hear it again. Every Christian has a corporate purpose in Christ. And what I mean by corporate purpose is, I mean every Christian, God has some divine purposes that's true of each and every one of us individually. But he has some corporate purposes that he expects of his church. And every Christian has a corporate responsibility, and you've heard me say this multiple times, is to give God the maximum amount of glory, to be a blessing to others, and to expand his kingdom. So Paul says in verse 13 that this freedom that we got from Jesus Christ, we are not using it as an opportunity of the flesh. Because being a slave to sin is to be chained to your own selfish desires. Paul doesn't want us to use this freedom that we got from Jesus Christ as an opportunity to work in our own flesh, because whether we realize it or not, that's exactly how we got into the problem from the beginning. Working out of our selfish flesh. Instead, the scripture tells us, now that you attained your freedom, you should serve one another. And this is where most people fail. Because in this particular verse, serve means to love. The scripture says, now that you got freedom in Jesus Christ, you ought to love one another.
Amen.
And this is not just what you do for someone you know. I love my son, I love my wife, but because I do something for them don't make it worth a whole lot to God. When I do something for someone that can't get nothing in return, God says, then people will know you by the love you have. As a matter of fact, it's a beautiful statement here. In Matthew 5:46, it says again, he says, even the pagans, even those people that believe and flying spaghetti monsters, even those people that believe in all kinds of weird things, they love people who love them back. You ain't done that all that great, Troy. But instead, now that you have that freedom that is in Jesus Christ, love your neighbor. In Matthew 5:44-45, he says, "But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those that persecute you." And then God puts a requirement for your salvation on that. He says that you might be children of the Father of Heaven. I want y'all to pay attention to this, because earlier it says when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we are adopted in the family of God. God says, but to be adopted in the family of God, you have to love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. What God is telling us, it says, there's a mindset, there's a way that God is, and he wants the people who are in his family to have those same characteristics. He says, "I've been forgiving you for all that mess you've been in, and I need you to forgive others for that same mess." Amen. He says, "Or else maybe you're not part of my family, even though you've done this, all these things." And this gets hard for Christians. It's very scary, because our adoption into the family of God rests on our ability to be like God. We see this same concept in Matthew 6:14-15. It is the conclusion of the Lord's Prayer. Everybody knows the Lord's Prayer, and I love the Lord's Prayer, but everyone stops at verse 13. But it goes on in verse 14 and 15. It says, "For if you forgive others their offenses, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well." You see, God put a pretext on forgiving you. He says, in order to get my forgiveness, you got to be given your forgiveness. But, and I know this to be true, because the next verse says, "But if you don't forgive others, neither will the Father forgive you." Now, I don't want y'all to get this wrong, but I'm pretty sure, man, you can discern, you can translate this, you can reiterate it as you want, but I'm pretty sure if God is not forgiving you, you're probably not adopted into his family. God makes these stipulations because he wants you to know his character. And he wants you to know the character of those who are adopted into his family. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 14 and 15, Paul tells the Galatians, "And you and I, we need not to be tempted by those who try to make us submit to the law to be accepted." He says, every law, he was talking about the Mosaic law. There were 613 laws that the Jews had. He said all those 613 laws that the Jews have been dependent on are fulfilled in this one great law: love your neighbor as you love yourself. And then he says, but if you knit and bite at each other, be careful that you don't eat each other up. And this is what we have today. Every group is doing everything we can to nip and bite at the other group. We're trying to instate new laws to make them obey our view of freedom. New laws about marriage, new laws about abortions, new laws about everything you can imagine. I did some research last night, and did you know there were over 20,000 laws on gun control in our federal government? Here's the scary group. There's one group of people who goes around collecting laws in this United States, and they say there is literally one law for every person in the United States. And to give you an idea, there's 340 million people in the United States. And there's a law for each and every one of us. 340 million laws. And with 340 million laws, we have a book of laws that literally is over 8,000 pages in Congress. And growing. Probably grew 3 or 4 times since yesterday. And growing. And the scary thing is, as we increase more and more laws, We're no closer to reaching a solution to our problem. We're no closer to a nation where justice and freedom is made for everybody. Everybody, no matter what race, no matter what creed, no matter what color, no matter what religion, no matter what sexual orientation, everybody says there's somebody out there who needs to stop doing something to me. Or there's something we need to write a law for that will stop someone from treating me this way. Or get someone to give me something. Or convince someone that I'm right in this area. We're just making laws after laws after laws, and we've forgotten the one great law given to us by Jesus Christ. Paul says, for the whole law, every law that's in Congress is fulfilled in one statement: love your neighbor as you love yourself. And this is heaven's key to earthly problems. Now, if I can, I want to finish up, and we're going to do communion, but I want to finish up today with an excerpt from Martin Luther King's I Had a Dream speech. This was August 28th, 1963. And it goes, I had a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that my four children one day will live in a nation where they'll not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream where every valley shall be exalted and every hill shall be made a law. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of God shall be revealed to all flesh at one time together. And he said, let freedom reign. Because if we let freedom ring, every village and every hamlet, every state and every city, when we let freedom ring, every community will be able to speed up the day when all God's children, black men and white men, black sisters and white sisters, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing the words of the old Negro spiritual. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we're free at last.
That's my word.